So this panel is the culmination of the first major collaboration between the David Rockefeller Center and the South Asia Institute. And for that, we're very grateful to the project's founder, Rahul Mehrotra. He is chair of the Department of Urban Planning and Design at the GSD, and he's been part of the Doctor Class Overseas Faculty Series. He has visited our office in Chile, and we hope to welcome him back this fall. And he's also been a recipient of a David Rockefeller Center faculty grant. In case you're wondering, as I was, what is meant by ephemeral urbanism, as a sort of primer, I just wanted to read two sentences that are on the wall texts of the exhibition upstairs. First, the scale and pace of contemporary urbanization challenges the notion of permanence as a basic condition of cities. And second, ephemeral landscapes of pop-up settlements are constantly increasing in scale and confronting the notion of the city as a stable and permanent entity. So tonight, Professor Mehrotra will moderate a conversation across disciplines about ephemerality and landscapes of South Asian and Latin American cities. This collaboration is very much in line with Drew Faust's, the president of Harvard's, vision of One Harvard, and it's a great example of South-South collaboration and research that has a real-world impact. So we're very pleased to have you all here, especially since some of you are coming to Cambridge for the second time this season. Tonight, I'm standing in for my colleague, Marcela Ramos, who runs the arts program at Doctor Class, and she's based out of our office in Santiago, Chile, one of the three David Rockefeller Center offices in Latin America. Marcela worked with the curators of this exhibition that is corresponding to the panel. The exhibition is called The Ephemeral City, Looking at Temporary Landscapes of Religion in South Asia and Latin America. It's on view upstairs in the second and fourth floors until July 15th. And I would like to thank her for her work in absentia. So Felipe Vera and Jose Mayoral, who are conversing here in the front, they're both former students of Rahul, and they're the exhibition curators and key actors in the organization of tonight's event. Felipe and Jose are going to present the exhibition that I just mentioned before the beginning of the roundtable discussion. So they'll each speak for a few minutes, and then the discussion will be led by Professor Mehrotra. So after you two are done speaking, Mina Hewitt, the executive director of the South Asia Institute, will come introduce Professor Mehrotra. We'll have the presentations and roundtable, some Q&A, and we'll follow everything with a reception outside in the concourse area at 7:30. To briefly introduce the panelists, Felipe and Jose, Felipe Vera is a professor at the design lab of the Universidad Adolfo Ibáñez in Santiago, where he directs the Center for Ecology, Landscape, and Urbanism. He holds a master's in design from the GSD and is currently a visiting fellow in the Department of Urban Planning and Design at the GSD. He has written and published extensively on the topic of ephemeral urbanism, contributing to several journals and books, and he recently co-edited the book Cumela, Mapping the Ephemeral Megacity, which you'll hear about tonight. Jose Mayoral is a licensed architect from Spain with professional experience in several international architectural firms, including Herzog and de Meuron. After studying in Barcelona and the Netherlands, he completed a Master's of Architecture at the University of Seville and holds a Master's of Architecture from Harvard University. Jose is currently a research and teaching associate at the Graduate School of Design, and he is investigating the phenomenon of ephemeral urbanism. So please join me in welcoming Felipe and Jose.
Good evening. This shouldn't happen. Okay, I imagine this being a much intimate gathering, and this room is not collaborating a lot. But because what I'm going to talk about actually now, if we get the presentation, it's telling you about a research we have been working on for the last 2 years with Rahul. Seems that it's working now. It's not.
Here's our friend.
I'm sorry. Probably the wire. Thank you very much. So I don't know if the light's going to go a bit down because I have several. And something moved also, like the presentation. Okay, so it doesn't matter. We can imagine what is the rest of the screen. Okay, what? So I want to tell you like very closely how this started and how do we get to this issue of the ephemeral city, and how we have been unpacking a little bit the subject with some of you that actually are in the room, which is very nice. With Rahul, Rahul's going to talk about the Kumela. We just published this book. But it really started as looking at a city that gathers 120 million people for 55 days in India. It is a completely functional city, and after doing that research, one of the main questions was, what could we really extrapolate from those lessons, and I don't know if this can go right, but for other things like refugee camps and big, massive gatherings and celebrations, and then we realized, and we start mapping several other temporary landscapes. And then we start this research project on the ephemeral city, which is what I'm going to talk today. I'm just going to share a bunch of images. First, we just also published this book, which is about Andrea Branci and looks at the 10 recommendations that Andrea does for rethinking the Athens Charter. And there is one that is particularly tied to this subject, and he says it's his sixth recommendation. These are like of provocations for the Athens Charter that happened after the Siam Congress. So he says one of the recommendations is we have to, if we want to think of the city for the next millennium, we need to design light, temporary, reversible infrastructure, build roads, bridges, connections with non-rigid, non-definitive, and removable logistical systems that leave no trace on the ground, and that adapt to the change of local needs over time. This, for me, was very clear how this could be useful. When we think of how the scale and pace of urbanization, as Edding was mentioning, challenge the notion of permanence as a basic condition for cities. And cities are growing on time as being like more malleable, changing more quickly. And so we think that from all these contexts, like of these temporal pop-up settlements that I'm going to show you, we could learn some lessons that could be applied to rethinking the permanent city or finding impermanence within the more permanent settlements. Actually, every city, when it's analyzed over large temporal spans, even this city becomes an ephemeral city. Because at some point, the room we're using right now is not going to be there. It's going to completely change or disappear. So internally, there is certain ephemerality anyway. So Bishop and William ask us this question, which is, given the overwhelming evidence that cities are complex overlays of buildings and activities that are, in one way or another, temporary, why have been so focused on permanence? That's something that really resonated with what we wanted to do after the research on the Kumela. And there are other more radical authors that actually put the question and frame the question in a much more aggressive way, like Giorgio Agamben, which he actually argues that under capitalism logics, it is not the city, but rather the camp, which is like the biopolitical paradigm of the West. So with this in mind, so we have this changing city, we have accelerating urbanization, we have this idea of the camp as an underlying logic for cities contemporary capitalism society, we start this research project on the ephemeral city, looking at cities that had in a certain way an expiry date. So we start mapping different taxonomies. We started with rituals, so all cities that were related with religion, then cities that pop up for celebrations like Burning Man. So religion could be the Kumela, celebration could be the Burning Man. Then extraction, all the mining, the mining cities that Luis will talk about today, for instance, are in a way or another tied to the life cycle of a particular resource. So in a way, they are also ephemeral in a larger temporal span. Disasters. We realize there are like hundreds of thousands of cities popping up at every moment to respond to disaster and give shelter as like holding strategies. And also what Marianne is going to talk, like ephemeral landscape of refuge. So we came up with all these taxonomies and we gather and map, and what you will see on the second and fourth floor is just those are tied to religion. Also transaction is in a way, and several others. So now I'm just going to show you several images. This is the Hajj, this is the Durga Puja, this is Navratri, this is Kolauritri in Peru, these are ephemeral cities that are created after religious practices, like the Ganesh festival. All of them really transform very aggressively either the permanent or the impermanent city. And there are also things like Lo Vázquez, as we have here, that allowed us to rethink absolutely one urban infrastructure that becomes like a path for peregrination. Also the Cumela, that is what Rahul will talk afterwards. And like this, we have gathered several, like Holi, that happens every year. And disasters, natural disasters are like changing completely the geography of the place in which they happen. So it's also not the ephemerality only of the built environment, but of the geography as well. There are several. I just wanted to show you that what we are going to talk about and the research we are showing on the show that is on the second and fourth floor is part of a bigger ecology of cases. So disasters is the second one. And then these are like cases like Haiti, the Philippines, Chile, that has had several natural disasters. Or this is a map actually, I think, done by you, which is of refugee, from refuge. There are several cities, like 47 million people live in refugee camps. So if we don't consider those cities as those camps as cities, then there is a big question mark on what a great part of a urban, like the built environment is. So these are all like images that are showing you what are we looking here. These are like the graph showing where are they and what, how many, what are these 45 millions of refugees? And on the other side of the spectrum, we have all these massive celebrations that really either change the urban fabric by including massive gatherings or create other pop-up cities like Exit in Serbia, like Coachella in California, like Sziget in Budapest, or the Burning Man, which is small for us because it's only 40,000 people, but it's actually very big. But they're bigger, like 350 million people here in Glastonbury. And these are all pop-up cities that has not been yet included as part of the imagination of urbanism. That's the claim we're trying to make. So we have to start looking at what are the patterns, what we can learn from all this. This is beautiful because this is an image of Africa burned, which is after the Burning Man. All these other extraction cities. So there are several cities on the ocean that are built just for extracting oil, for instance, which is this case, or mining, what Luis will talk, that really change completely the environment, bringing other challenges like how do we deal with more ecological concerns. They not only change the surface but also change the underground, which is also crazy if we think another scale, another thickness, but it's actually ephemeral. So it's just I have a bunch of images. So other like military or research centers, like places all over the place, or transactions, as we were talking, different markets, which are very interesting as well as a case. Or even this, which is like, when we also have considered disruption, like disruptive, like Occupy New York, as another possibility as another expression of what could be an ephemeral occupation of space, in which the use of space change radically. I just want to end with a short video, which is actually something that Aya, which is there, found and show us, which help us understand a little bit what we think, the kind of lessons we can learn. So we always think of infrastructure as being something that is very monofunctional, something that at least in the countries of the north, it's just occupied to transport goods or to they're like scarce in the city in a way. So this is an example that really could help us thinking about how just juxtaposition of uses could be really challenge the way in which we think of those by looking at this, what we argue is one of the cases we're looking at in the context of ephemeral cities of transaction. There is this rail train in Thailand, and you have all these market that pop-ups and moves very flexibly, so it brings adjustability, it changes completely, and it allows a very unexpected occupation of the space. So it's crazy the way in which the space it's occupied, and the reversibility in a way also of the physical space. So if we imagine for a moment how many highways we have in cities, and how we can start also collapsing a bit the functionalities of them just by looking provocatively at this case. So just opening to what Jose is going to show you, now, and the exhibit that is on the second and fourth floor, it's more about landscapes of religion. This is a map that shows a little bit the size and how much they last. And we can see the Kumela highlighted, which is what Rahul is going to talk about here. So Jose, please.
So the Rockefeller Center and the South Asia Institute gave us the opportunity to present this research that Felipe was explaining. The exhibition, The Ephemeral City, Looking at the Temporary Landscapes of Religion in South Asia and Latin America, takes place in this building on the second and on the fourth floor. And you will encounter with maps, introductory panels that explain the scope of the research, and 12 case studies of ephemeral urbanism. Six of them from Latin America and six of them from South Asia. This content takes form in quotes, panels, and screens, as you will see if you walk around the exhibition. The exhibition can be understood its entirety between the two levels, as well as its experience on each floor as a cohesive exhibition, with the aspiration of starting a dialogue between the South Asia Institute and the Rockefeller Center. The selection of the cases are interwoven in such a way that some cases of South Asia are on the second floor and some cases from Latin America are on the fourth floor. So the main challenge for us when we were thinking about how to design this exhibition was how to present the temporary nature of all these cases that we were analyzing. We use materiality as a tool to express the light and temporal condition of the exhibition. The panels, as you can see here, are printed on fabric. The material, which is used in the physical construction of many of the cases, also reflects on the lightness and weightless character of all these temporal events. Through the analysis of all these cases, we came to realize that it was actually the activity itself that it was celebrated, and not the built form itself. For this reason, the dynamism and multiplicity of scenarios could not be expressed by one single image, but rather a juxtaposition of multiple images. The exhibition not only conveys the temporary character of the research, but also shows the entire spectrum and potential of the research, including a more in-depth and comprehensive analysis of the case studies. As you can see in the wall maps, and as you can see as we jump into the case studies. So, yeah, as I was saying, the research explain the whole spectrum and potential of the entire research by having all these wall maps and introductory panels, but at the same time, it does an emphasis on all these different case studies. Each of the case studies emphasizes one particular aspect that is relevant for the urban system. In this case, the Kumbamela is reversibility. In the next case, Ganesh is dissolution. So I just wanted to explain briefly this exhibition, and I hope you, after this event, you go upstairs, walk around, and this exhibition is able to engage you with ephemeral urbanism research as you walk through the CGIS. Now we're moving to the panel, and Mina will introduce Rahul Mehrotra.
I think it gives me great pleasure to actually introduce you, Rahul. I started to Google and see, okay, what should I say about Rahul? And it's like 500,000 entries show up. So there's way too much to talk about Rahul. But I think personally, I would just say Rahul has been at Harvard for about 4 years. Prior to that, he was at MIT and then at Michigan. But Rahul is sort of, he's a culmination of many things. He is a practitioner. He has his own practice in Mumbai. He's an educator. He's a mentor to many people. He is also an administrator. I think the list is endless. Rahul has written books. He continues to teach different studios relating to conservation, cities, architecture. He's designing buildings. So I'm sorry. There's a lot of information on Rahul out there. He's an amazing person. And please help welcome Rahul to this event today.
Thank you, Meena. And this is really a pleasure to be here and to be part of this and have you all here. A lot of you have been part of this, you know, these discussions for a long time. I want to particularly thank, well, the South Asia Institute and the Rockefeller Center, but I really want to thank Ned because in many ways, no, seriously, and now you're here and I sort of hadn't completely registered in that way. But it was really in a conversation maybe a year and a half ago that we began to talk about, with all these centers at Harvard, why don't we actually create a dialogue on the South-South kind of sets of issues? And it's wonderful that this finally happened with all your help. And the exhibition, I hope, is just a first step in trying to create more collaborations, because honestly, in the research we've been doing and, you know, we're collaborating with people you'll see on the panel, we realize that there's so much resonance between the issues in that set of geographies across the South. And with these two wonderful centers here, mentored by wonderful people, I think we should do more of this. So thanks, Ned, for triggering that off over a lunch conversation, and lovely to see you here. Thank you all. I'm going to, you know, go through the Kumbh Mela. Now, this is a book, so I don't want to belabor it, because we hope you'll get the book instead of sort of getting all the info in a presentation. So I'm going to go through these quite rapidly, really at Felipe's insistence, because I think we should be jumping into the panel. But all of this might become the basis for some of the reflections that the panel members will sort of do. So this was, an early project to look at the Kumbh Mela, which is essentially a religious festival. So it has a very single purpose, which is what makes it interesting, because when we try to compare it, I mean, I'm often asked the question, especially in India, what do you learn from the Kumbh Mela and how can we learn for Indian cities? And actually even unfair to imagine it. Yes, of course, there are many lessons, but one of the things that makes the Kumbh Mela stand out is that it is a gathering, you can call it an ephemeral city or a temporary city, but with a very singular purpose. So the contestations disappear because everyone there is for the same reason and you have to make it work. But even then, I think there are many interesting things about it, in the way it sits on this geography, the confluence of these two rivers, 10 kilometers. It's massive in its sort of scale. I'm sorry, I'm just going to go through these to give you, and it's about pilgrimage. It's about the sacred bath. The function or the purpose becomes even more focused because it's about bathing on 5 particularly holy days. The statistics are rather staggering in terms of what it deploys as infrastructure, and that's why one has to take it seriously as a form of urbanism or a city, because it's an amazing organizational sort of feat, even in terms of just the scale of things that sort of are taken care of. Just a comparison, that sort of the Kumbh Mela in red with Manhattan, so that's how big it is. But I think what was wonderful about this, and you mentioned the One Harvard idea, and I think now collaborating with the David Rockefeller Center, was this is something the South Asia Institute, a lot of credit to Meena for this, to facilitate this process of actually getting several schools to work. And I think the reason it did happen was I mean, I only in retrospect began to think about it, is that it was an out-of-the-box problem, which means no one had preconceptions of what we were studying. Even the design school students didn't know what the form of this would be, even though we were defining it as a city. And the fact that it was so out-of-the-box in terms of our own imagination, it allowed interdisciplinary transgressions, which were very interesting because people depended on each other's perceptions to try to understand this collectively. So I think this was a very important aspect of it. And that's when the river is in full flow. And when it recedes in October, the officials get 2 months to set up this entire city. So that also is a staggering fact that in about 7 or 8 weeks, they can erect the infrastructure, which will then accommodate 7 million people for a period of 55 days. That's an image I took there, you know, when we had gone on one of our early recces. And then when we went back in January from the same spot, the whole city had kind of unfolded at our feet. So again, staggering. In terms of scale. That was a camp that we lived in. And so here, these are just some before and afters from the same spot, which just tells you how in that geography, the city, the river recedes and the city sort of emerges. And so this documentation sort of was very systematic in terms of capturing these different vistas at different times from the same spot so that we could understand how that occupation happened. The man who runs the city is a commissioner of Allahabad from the government. And it goes back to agriculture, so to speak, at the end. So the mapping involved actually creating physical maps, looking at the situation at different points before and after. It involved, so these were all the kind of images and maps of the site, in a sense, before the city sort of set up. In any case, I'm going to sort of, these are the kinds of maps that were produced. The bridges, which is very important infrastructure there because you've got to actually cross the river. And essentially, it's about the grid extending across the river. So there are a series of bridges so which kind of keep the grid intact in spite of the river. And the river is different every 12 years, but the idea sort of stays because the grid is such a neutral element. And this is where the great bath happens. And so amazing amount of infrastructure there, the leveling of the site, the first level of infrastructure. So this is over a period of time, making the site sacred, which is a ritual that sort of goes on after it's allocated. And then the priests mark those different sites within the subgrids. And then they begin to sort of erect the city. And there's a lot of negotiation in the process of occupation. And it's all these sorts of materials. There are about 4 or 5 materials, cloth, canvas, bamboo, rope, and some corrugated metal. The entire city is made from those 5 metal, from those 5 sort of materials that get unpacked from previous times. New materials come in, and a whole lot of infrastructure, including sanitation, toilets, you know, water supply, sewage. It's all sort of put in very, very quickly. And so, of course, I mean, one learned a lot, especially in terms of governance, in terms of deployment, but also these sort of critical theoretical questions of do we unnecessarily often respond to temporary problems with permanent solutions? How do we deal within the discourse of urbanism around the question of reversibility and what does that mean? Can we actually design things which are reversible? Can we design things that have an expiration date, which has implications on the material life cycles? The life cycles of materials that we use, how we deploy them, and what sort of happens with them. These are community halls that also exist there, which create a great social life within the city. And these structures, so to speak, are of different scales because the sense of community is very strong. So therefore, the sense of community spaces becomes very important as opposed to a refugee camp where you're actually dissipating or you're deconstructing identities and disaggregating it. So you don't often in those kinds of settlements, and Marianne will talk about that, you don't have a sense of this kind of requirement. But this is the texture here is of habitation, of community, congregation, of sanitation, of healthcare, and all of that. So this is very typical that you have these encampments, but they also have a community hall. These are just people who are sort of visiting it. And there's a completely different texture across the different parts of the settlement. And they carry the village often with them, and they replicate patterns from the parts of the country they come to, which is also a matter of study, which of course we could not engage with in great detail, but there are many lessons that one could also, you know, an anthropologist would be very excited by studying those kinds of relationships within each of these sectors and quarters, which is also very interesting. And of course, the bathing is the spectacle of the thing, and these are all the high priests who are offering the river goddess, the Ganges, their offerings of pure milk and prayer, and there's rituals that is related to it, which is essentially sort of, it's a singular purpose, as I said. And then it's dismantled. It sort of very quickly disappears. Within 2 weeks, it's also dismantled, and the material is sort of sent out to be recycled in smaller towns. It leaves little memories like the mats that were under the tents where people slept, but that gets sort of swept away finally when the river sort of floods. And so the exercise was also about capturing the deconstruction and the and then it gets converted into agriculture. As they're removing the infrastructure, the farmers have one season before the monsoon, they can grow one crop. So they begin to use the grid to then cultivate crops, and you have agriculture. You can see these fields have been tilled to ready it. And then, of course, the Ganges floods again. It leaves no memory of the city. And within a few months, it completely sort of disappears. And so I think that really is broadly what the study was about. And of course, one can talk about this in more detail, but for another time, and look at the book. We want to sell more copies of the book, I guess. But I just wanted to very quickly do this, just to complement Felipe's presentation, but also as a way that our panelists might reflect upon these things as they are, these cases, as they also talk about their observations and their particular sort of areas of research. So our three panelists, I'm going to quickly introduce them. Felipe Hernandez, I'm really glad he's here to join us. He is here for the semester at the GSD, and he's an architect and professor of architectural design, history, and theory, and currently the director of the MPhil in Architecture and Urban Studies at Cambridge, at King's College in Cambridge, where he directs these studies there. He has worked and published extensively on Latin America and other areas in the developing world, including Africa, the Caribbean, and Southeast Asia. Felipe has written about urbanism. He's done a book called Baba for Architects, which is Homi Baba for Architects. He's also done a book on architecture, contemporary architecture in Latin America, on informal settlements, a very wide range of interests, and a true scholar. And I'm glad he's here with us for the semester. Luis Valenzuela, he is also a visiting fellow from Chile. He's been at the GSD, a wonderful presence for the last 6 or 9 months. He also studied here, a doctor of design from the Graduate School of Design, and has a master of architecture from the university in Chile. In 2011, when he went back to Chile, founded the Territorial Intelligence Center, and it's an ongoing collaborative and applied research project. And he's teaching the course Advanced Research Seminar towards an evidence-based design at the GSD this semester. As a visiting fellow and as part of this class, he's also run a field trip to look at sites of extraction and towns that are related to it, which is very interesting, and I hope he might tell us a little bit about it. So thank you for being here, Luis. And Marianne Potvin, who holds an MDes from the GSD, is currently a PhD candidate here at Harvard. And her studies sort of create an intersection between humanitarian and sort of design issues and concerns and urbanism. And her aim really in the studies to uncover the spatial logic of these sort of humanitarian interventions. And she draws on critical urban theory, science, technology, society studies, as well as critical legal studies, and is sort of seeking in this work that she's doing to define new linkages between, you know, law, particularly the notion of humanitarian space, and the idea of the right to the city for refugees and other displaced communities and individuals, something that's happening more and more on this planet. So her work is of great relevance. So I'm going to invite you guys to come up to the panel, and perhaps, Felipe, we could start with you, and you might you want to use some slides?
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you very much. I'd like to thank Rahul and Felipe and Jose for the invitation and the opportunity to come and speak. I feel almost like a foreigner, truly, in the sense that I'm really not part of the team that has been working for such a long time on this issue of ephemeral urbanism. And I suppose declare the fact that I do approach the notion of ephemerality in architecture through informality. So the kind of activities that are So the kind of activities that people do perform in developing world cities in order to find sort of a livelihood sometimes in cities that are incredibly large, very large populations of many millions of people, sometimes also in very high density. So there is a certain spontaneity in the way in which people appropriate spaces constantly in order to develop productive activities so they can actually survive in economic environments which are sometimes very hostile. Of course, the interest that I have is the fact that this idea of ephemeral or transient occupations, transient architectures, the transformations that people do in cities sometimes. I the other thing I have to say is I don't work at the same scales that you have seen before of millions of people occupying spaces temporarily. I work at sort of much smaller scales. but those occupations, even though they are temporary, very short periods, sometimes sort of periods of a few hours during the day, they do have a permanent dimension. And this is the aspect that I find fascinating. One of the first, and also I suppose there are two aspects that I'm going to be addressing today, is the permanent dimension of the transient or the ephemeral, and also the international impact of those transient architectures. So I just want to talk about three cases very quickly, because I've been told 5 minutes, so 5 minutes it'll be. So one of the things is one of the case studies that we've been mapping and investigating is this activity in Nanjing in China. So visiting one of the urban villages in Nanjing, you can see the conditions of the architecture. This is supposed to be temporary. These people who are in these villages are going to be removed anytime from these things, even though the local government is building walls in order to prevent that there is visibility of these urban villages. We encountered this fabulous space in there. Sort of somebody was actually building Chinese lanterns. So we go inside to talk to this person, and this person gives me a card. This is a translation of what the card says. This person has got all sorts of titles. And he asked me where I come from. So I said, I come from the University of Cambridge. He says, oh, Cambridge, I've been to Cambridge. I've been there to teach children how to make Chinese lanterns. And the conversation goes on. And then turns out that his activity from that little space in Nanjing, China, he sends lanterns to New York, San Francisco, Toronto, Perth, Melbourne. Those are the places that he reaches from his little space in an urban village, in a transient space in Nanjing. So all of a sudden we discover that there is a tremendous reach. There is a kind of sort of international dimension in an international economy that happens from within these very temporary spaces. We relate these to the temporary occupation of spaces in Cali in Colombia, where we can see also that the products that are sold by these people are products that come from all sorts of places around the world, especially sort of Korea, China, and they arrive in these markets through legal channels. They are not contraband, they are actually imported, but they go to the streets and they somehow they find their way out of the formal economy into the informal economy to reach markets that couldn't be reached otherwise. But the ways in which those people there occupy the streets is rather permanent. They have fixed spaces that have been allocated to them by the local government in kind of extra legal manners. So somehow the planning office has allocated spaces to street vendors. So they're always there. So there is those people are not there. They know where they are going to be there tomorrow. So there is something that is very interesting is this sort of idea of permanence and international dimensions to the transient.
And the final example is this much more transient, much more ephemeral, if you like, which is the Luna Park in Cali, in Colombia. This is the theme park that happens during December, during the December celebrations. And it's a theme park, it's a traveling theme park that always happens for the past 46 years in exactly the same place in the city, right? It occupies an important space in the city, one of the major roads next to the bullfighting arena, which is also an activity that happens during the December period. And it there is a map. It happens always there. It's a tremendously large traveling thing that also travels outside the country. It's not just a Colombian thing. But the site that it occupies was going to be built. It's prime real estate land. And they were going to build, planning permission was approved. But as soon as it was announced that they were going to build on this site, there was a movement by the local people asking, and where are we going to have our theme park if they are going to build there? So all of a sudden there was this the appearance of this memory value of something that is transient that all of a sudden is defended by the community. Even though it's considered to be grotesque by many people, it acquires a particular value which is attached to the memory of the city. So something that is very important. So just to leave you with these two aspects, which is the fact that there is something of an international economic impact of the transient, of the ephemeral, of ephemeral urbanisms, international dimension, and the fact that those transient architectures produced by these people who occupy space in the streets and the ephemeral urbanisms do contain a sense of permanence that is very important in the development of cities. Thank you.
Thanks. Luis.
Good afternoon. Thank you everyone for being here. Thank you for all the organizers. Thank you Rahul, Felipe, Jose, for this invitation. And yes, I'm going to try to talk a little bit about extraction, and I'm going to title this as our research seminar has been coming this semester, and it will come out by December, we hope, as a book, The City and the Camp. So what is the city and the camp in the perspective of the ephemerality, of the perspective of temporality? And I like very much this photograph, and Felipe is repeating the image we had. We participated in another lecture, seminar in the Kennedy School of Government. Because this is an image of Calama, and Calama is one of the biggest mining enclaves in Chile, and we believe that in Latin America. And what you see in this image is really striking. You see this at least three different speeds or different velocities of ephemerality or temporality in the city. You see first the old, the most permanent, the most aging, which is quite on the back, a very narrow, thin line of green, which is the oasis and the longest river along the Atacama Desert in Chile. Back in the down in the image, you see the vernacular settlement that has been aging already around 300 years. But then in the middle, in the epicenter, you see the new striving velocities, the new striving speeds of extraction as they manifest themselves in real estate projects, in high-rise buildings here. And these different speeds or different velocities of development and in the same time and space is our way of seeing ephemeral in the extraction. It's not ephemeral against what is permanent, but is actually the ephemeral as you have a different overlaying of situations that are quite striking to understand. And because they're quite striking and difficult to understand, is that the designer, and here you see my friend Alejandro Ravena, we have very difficult times in how to figure out how to intervene, how to operate in these environments. And we usually operate in the city. We do master plans to the city. We design projects of infrastructure, parks, plazas, schools, etc., etc. And it's not bad. It's not wrong. But it's not enough. The other part of this territory, the other part of the city, is the camp and is this reality. And this reality lives together with the city permanently. It operates with the city. It functions with the city. It is with the city. This is Chuquicamata, the largest open site of mine, copper mine in the world. 1 kilometer deep, the hole that you see there. It's so striking that you see the ephemerality manifested as most magnificent expression of these huge mountains of debris that are laid out. Or even the new ones that are here, that they actually dug, covered one of the most modern and sophisticated hospitals in the area, because they didn't have any place else to put in an economical and feasible way the debris, the waste of the mine. So they actually dumped the whole hospital in that place and moved this whole Chuquicamata camp towards the city. So these movements, this continued movement of extraction that moves people, that moves resources, that moves mine, moves acid, moves fuel, etc., is part of this whole understanding of the city. Here you have a new framework of ephemerality for this territory, which is an expanded territory. It's not a territory inside the city. It's a territory much broader than that. You see here Kalama, you see Chuquicamata, you see the tailing dams there in that edge. The tailing dam itself is already 3 or 4 times the city. So this comes to the theory, not only of Neil Brenner, one of the faculty at the GISD, but other Henry Lefebvre, that the whole world is a continuous urbanization, and there's no, in the sense of overlapping geographies, overlapping times, velocity, temporalities. We can actually understand the whole world not as a place of city and what is out of the city, but everything as an urbanization. If you look to that idea in a spatial manifestation, in an extraction site, you have this very interesting collage that I made, but also not very good one, so bear with me in it, that it's not only the hole that we're digging in to take mineral out, and that we use a lot of big trucks and big heavy things to load with all that earth, and we pile it up on the side covering these hospitals and all these camps, but also you need a center of operation that some people call the city, but other people call the industry, the airport. And you need the airport because you have a huge floating population that flies in and flies out in different shifts of time. And you need the huge transatlantic boats actually to ship the mineral up to the worldwide global supermarkets. So when you're looking into a problems of extraction, you're not looking onto the city, but the camp and this extended and expanded territory. It is probable that the conflict that raises from these places over the resource of extraction may lead progressive institutional change, and it does sometimes. It has led towards revolution, as in Mexico, for example. So the ephemerality, we could say, in territories of extraction has been grounds for protest and radicalization. It's a radical territory. While our response of urban planning and design has been to see the conventional city as a solution and a proposal to it, physical infrastructures of proposals to do that, the ephemeral in change opens up new frameworks for theory and practice, and we have to cope to that radical idea. So this is the radical idea, I think, on the beginning of the 19th century, when people were actually crossing around different goods on the Valley of Kalama, and you have the oasis on the back. And this was actually a free combination of different elements, not only the city on the back, but the production that you needed to have, the extraction where these workers were flying on to get to the place, and the preservation as the oasis that you see also there along the city. So in that sense, we have been able, or we have a certain kind of a certain array of research and theoretical and practice around what we think is the city, places of production, extraction as ephemeral and preservation, and we are coping with understanding those, but there's a whole new range of combinations of these expanded territories in these different categories. It could be this ones or it could be different ones. And all of them combined layer up these different dimensions that we've been talking about in this case of Kalama. And these are early maps, just to give you an example of these different combinations of categories, which are combinations of temporalities, like the city and the extraction, where you have Kalama, but then you have not only Chuquicamata, but other 15 operating mines that have a functional relationship to Kalama. When you see the city and you see transportation and you see congestion, it's not the congestion about that many people in Kalama like to ride the cars, but actually are the mining operators, the services for mining and the outsourcing of mining that actually operate of Kalama as a big campsite and as a strategic place. And as I said, floating population has increased heavily, which is the great amount here in Chile. So actually 1/3 of the people that work in mining are workers hired with a hired contract to the mining companies, and 2/3 are people working in mining, but they belong to companies that service and outsource this. And this has a huge impact because all these people move around and behave around this territory. And then the land of preservation, or the relationship between the city and the preservation. This is the lower river, the longest river, the oasis of Kalama, right there in that gray area that you see there. Right here, and these are the indigenous villages along the river. And the indigenous villages also pilgrim towards the city as their kids go from middle school to from elementary school to middle school, because there's no middle school in the small villages. So they have to migrate to the oasis and actually go and are a very important part of that. By then, each weekend they have to come back, or they like to go back to the older ones and to their homes and to these small villages. So there's this migration that actually works along in between this highly productive spaces that we have seen here. Along the mines, along the city, and along the indigenous peoples, these three temporalities, these three kinds of ephemerality that we were showing in the first image. And in between this congested and the competitive territory, there's such much competition for that that it comes to a paralyzation that you cannot actually act in terms of things that are happening in it and that you want to protect or you want to preserve. And everybody just looks as things go around. This is, for example, the case of the oasis, the forgotten yet missed oasis. This is the oasis in 1910 with the city of Kalama. And this is how it has evolved during 100 years up to this point. And we are actually calculating which will be the expiration date for the oasis. And nobody is able to, not even the governance of the city or the power corporation of the camp, are able actually to cope with this reality and this complexity to actually preserve some of the things are their identity. Thank you very much.
Okay, good evening, everybody. Thank you very much, Rahul, Felipe, and Jose, for inviting me. It's been just very stimulating so far, so I'm very pleased to be here. So today I'm going to bring the focus of our discussion on the question of refuge as another way to think about the ephemeral city. And I will focus specifically on the spaces of humanitarian refuge, which is kind of scrambled on the screen there. What I mean by humanitarian refuge are all those spaces that provide humanitarian protection to individuals fleeing violence, persecution, or the overwhelming destruction brought on by natural disaster, technological disaster, environmental disaster. So my objective here is to assess these changing geographies and changing temporalities of humanitarian refuge. What I've diagrammed here, and it's going to be also the structure of my presentation. So looking at these different modes with which humanitarian actors, or how humanitarian processes develop over time, I'm also studying the relationship between the camp and the existing local urban realm, or maybe what you would term as the permanent versus the ephemeral, so the little diagrammatic versus the blurb, which is the city. So through this study, I'm trying to challenge the accepted models that we use to think about spaces of refuge, and I try to understand or provide a new lens to understand what humanitarian spaces ought to be. So let's start with the first, the paradigmatic, the prototypical refugee camp, which is so pervasive in the literature and in the media. So this is the picture that we've all become too familiar with of these humanitarian enclosures. This is a camp in 1985 in Ethiopia, set up to offer protection from political and social failures, defined by relatively clear, imperious boundaries. They often appear to have been airdropped in the middle of nowhere, but always out of harm's way. This is a camp in Kabul in the beginning of the 2000s. also designed as being a temporary infrastructure defined by definition for a state of emergency. So obviously, camps are considered to be material inscriptions of humanitarian aspirations. They're generally thought of as being apolitical spaces. They're removed as far as possible from the reaches of power, and they aspire somehow to be the reflection in the built environment of the humanitarian ethos, that is, an ethos of neutrality, impartiality, such as is prescribed in international humanitarian law. But camps are also technical instruments, and here I'm showing an emergency medical kit from Doctors Without Borders. And I'm drawing a parallel here between the emergency medical kit, the solution in a box, and the camp as an integral part of the humanitarian aid apparatus. The goals that camps reflect in terms of sustainable public welfare and everyday life are highly limited, just as this emergency kit is. Echoing anthropologist of science Peter Redfield, we could say that just like the emergency kit system, the camp model is the exact opposite of local knowledge and of geographic and cultural specificity. To bring it back to our conversation about urbanism, camps are also a powerful technique of normalization, one that betrays a highly rationalized and systematic approach to urban planning. So this is an extract from the UNHCR handbook on the design of refugee camps. So while we were very familiar with this model, I'm arguing that the geographies now are changing. The nature of war and conflict are changing, new risks are emerging, and they are radically transforming the parameters of humanitarian action, resulting in new, denser, and more complex geographies of refuge. So the temporalities of humanitarian response are different. We only have to look at Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, to understand that protracted crises, that means prolonged emergencies, are now becoming the norm rather than the exception. And geographically speaking, conflicts are also being waged internally and often in dense, heterogeneous agglomeration. So these changes have resulted in different spatial imprints of humanitarian interventions onto the landscape. And here I'm noting two ways in which this is happening, and this is two ways also in which this is being analyzed. So the densification is occurring first as an aid archipelago, and I'll come back to that, and as the urbanization of the camp. So cultural theorist Ayel Weitzman speaks of aid archipelagos to describe the densification of humanitarian infrastructures that happen over time. On your left, this is a rough map of the network of refugee camps in Sierra Leone and Liberia, which illustrates kind of how these humanitarian settlements and corridors over time start to form constellation and networks. And they're also woven into existing economic networks and social networks as well. The term archipelago is not innocent at all. It alludes to this fundamental separation between humanitarian infrastructure and the specific terrains onto which it lands. So in other words, it alludes to this tension between extraterritorial humanitarian space and the local. So this is, I just added this slide this afternoon. This is a recent decision by the Kenyan authorities to close down the Dadaab refugee camp, which was prompted by the tragic events that happened earlier this month in Garissa. So this is a sad illustration of how refugee camps are indeed very much embedded in the political local. Another way to think about the densification, as I mentioned, is looking at the so-called urbanization of camps. This is a Za'atari camp, opened in 2012 in Jordan to host a Syrian refugee, estimated at about 80,000 currently. This is Dadaab, which I was just mentioning. It was constructed in the early 90s in Kenya to host Somalian refugees, and was considered at one point the largest refugee camp in existence, with 500,000 population in 2011. So these new conditions are no doubt rather remarkable. And the urbanization of camps has indeed become a favorite topic within the contemporary architectural and anthropological literature on humanitarian space. So much that it is, in my view, starting to resemble what I call a camp fetish. The literature frames this issue frequently, if not exclusively, around a camp to city binary. So the recurrent question is this one, or when does the camp become a city? And what does it take for a camp to become a city? And can it ever, in fact, really become a city? So this spatio-ethnographic work of Sahari refugee camps in Algeria from the ETH Zurich offers one interpretation on how the spaces of camps are indeed highly political, such as urban spaces. The same theme is also present in the work of Ayel Weitzman or Michel Agier, whose analysis constructively point to the lack of correspondence between the moral idea of humanitarian space and the collective appropriation of the city. So I'm not, this framework, the camp to city binary, provides a valid framework for thinking about the politics of humanitarian governed camps versus the politics of the refugee governed city. However, I feel that this frame of reference still remains based on the idea of the camp. So these three, the prototypical camp, and then these other two modes of analysis are also very much camp focused. I'm arguing for a new lens, which I called humanitarian urbanism, and I'm going to conclude with this example. So when I spoke earlier of camp fetish, I did not wish to discard the importance of camps as humanitarian tool, but I want to shift the focus on camps from another more pressing reality, which is what I call humanitarian urbanism. Today, the UNHCR, the United Nations Refugee Agency, recognizes that 2/3 of its population is concerned, so that is refugees, asylum seekers, other displaced populations, are now seeking refuge in non-camp city, in non-camp settings, as opposed to camps, often in urban centers. The Syrian refugee crisis, again, is a perfect example of this trend. I'm showing here the disjuncture that exists the situation that exists in Turkey and in Jordan, with the overwhelming majorities of refugees living outside of camps. This is also the case in Lebanon, and here I'm showing you there are now 1 million Syrian refugees living in Lebanon, and not a single camp has been constructed since the beginning of the crisis, by choice. It's a conscious decision. And I contrast this reality with the media portrayal of the Syrian refugee crisis, where the attention remains focused again and again on the camp. The same is true for Jordan. An incredible amount of media attention was given to the camp of Za'atari, and this is the camp of Azraq. But on the left, you can see an example of the actual distribution of refugees in Jordan. The gradation of color shows you that Syrian refugees are in fact in rural areas, semi-rural areas, urban areas. So while the humanitarian community is currently overwhelmed with the needs that exist outside of camps, this is where I see the concept of humanitarian urbanism as becoming crucially important. I think it's important to study it. It was my last slide. The camp fetish that I referred to prior is not at play only in the media and scholarly fascination with camps as the exemplar space of refuge. But it's also ingrained in the spatial strategies that humanitarian actors adopt. So the camp model is deeply ingrained in their institutional psyche and remains a technique and a frame of reference for the planning practices of humanitarian institutions. And this is, I think, what we have to challenge with our study of humanitarian urbanism. Thank you.
Thank you all for your presentations, but also sharing this sort of research and thinking in progress that you're all engaged with. And what was very striking is, I think, in all cases, the broadening of the definition, in a sense, that you're all concerned about how this sits within broader ecologies that it lives off, and finding ways of sort of defining it. And then, you know, going to open it up for questions, and we should treat this as a discussion. But Felipe, I just wanted to sort of start with you, because you sort of talked about how you're using this sort of lens of informality as a way of entering this question and this discussion. And I was really struck by the ways you defined the kind of the economic impact of this ephemeral, or transient was the word you kept using. Do you think we've reached a point, and I was struck by your graphics and your very pithy and clear kind of explanation or observation, do you think we've transcended the narrowness of the definition of informality, and that we might be ready to move into other categories that might be more productive? I'm asking this because it's interesting. You know, you've worked and thought about this deeply, and I couldn't but help think about that through your presentation.
I think that's a very, very important question indeed. I think that is true. I think that the notion of informality is largely limiting. And is largely limiting because of its associations to illegal, extra-legal, to poverty, and to things that happen outside regulatory frameworks. When we look at the activities that are described within the context of informality, we encounter that actually they're very closely associated to what is supposed to be its opposite, to informality. And one of the things that we've been doing is that, I don't know if you're familiar with the book that was published by Hernando de Soto a few years ago, and that is called the Mystery of Capital. But the subtitle of the book was Why Capitalism Triumphs in the West and Fails Everywhere Else. And one of the things that, you know, the implication is that informality, extralegality, the developing world countries have failed, and is they represent the failure of a capitalist economic system. We're trying to approach this from a different way. We're trying to sort of in simple terms to say actually capitalism has triumphed everywhere, and it is because it has triumphed everywhere that it has opened gaps of disparity and distribution of wealth, which generate these other activities, which are the activities that people develop in order to be able to participate in this larger economy. So basically what we're trying to say is that yes, informal activities, extra-legal activities, and all those things are inherently connected to, on the one hand, a history of globalization, colonialism, modernization, capitalism, and they're all embedded inside each other. Mm-hmm. So I suppose that yes, we need to be able to exceed the models of formality and informality as a dichotomy that are exclusive. Mm-hmm. By all standards.
And the other thing that was striking in all your presentations was also you can't map intent and many other dimensions and form very accurately. So the same forms of capitalism might take on another form elsewhere. So we often get limited also by the aesthetic of informality, or the aesthetics of the camp, or the, you know, aesthetics of settlements that we sort of grapple to kind of define. So I think those were some really interesting kind of commonalities, at least that I thought, so you're all trying to touch upon. And before I go on, let me actually open it up a little bit for questions from the audience, people who might want. Yeah, Axel.
Different representations of ephemerality is a kind of different understanding of time, and especially this dimension that time is challenged by this traditional linear understanding. So I'm wondering if you would like to elaborate further about time, and also how different understanding of time gives you a different understanding of the local environments and so on.
Luis, you want to start with that?
Yes, thank you.
It's a tough question and a nice question, actually. So I will try to respond it, at least on one of the dimensions that we have been working in the research throughout this semester with the students. We have very much understood time or ephemerality linked to space. So it's not about time in terms of how much is the expiration of some things, if this expires first than the other thing. It's not a competition in terms of a chronological competition, but that you have, at least in the case of extraction, you have different time cycles in different space expansions. So it's like these both both on vectors of understandings towards ephemerality, and we try to not put ephemerality next on the next box to time, but actually ephemerality in a certain way from our standing point, it is about these different time cycles and these different space expansions. Of which, again, as designers, and when you go to some places as Calama, people ask you, what would you do in the city to get it better? The mayor itself asks, how can we get a better master plan, you know? And it's very difficult to answer that kind of question, because you're actually looking to a specific box in this time. And I think that the phrase of Rahul explaining Kumbela about being out of the box is that perfect example, that the thing of ephemerality puts you out of the box, not only out of the city, but you have to think like different schemes of functionality working in different times and spaces. And that was the other issue that I can add towards not only time cycle and space, but also how does production in terms of, in this case of extraction was very clear, but of production, how does it happen? How does it operate? How does it function in these different levels, in these different situations? So infrastructures get a different significance, for example. Identity also has a new significance. And you have actually parallel worlds, as you saw in the image there, working, debating between themselves and trying to come up with their goals, you know. So you have in a certain way the production of mining, which tries to be efficient, tries to be very deterministic in terms of what they have to produce, what they have to invest, and what they have to take out. And from the other, and they have the one kind of cycle, one kind of layout in the space, and one kind of operation in the space. And then you have, on the other side, the communities looking for their identity, for their preservation spaces, for their better life quality. And they seek for another kind of illusion or vision, or they have another kind of goals. And these actually are in different time spaces. And they're today one of the main things and main hypotheses of the book that is Felipe is also collaborating in. I didn't mention that, is about how we can, through space, understand which are the connection points between those times.
Do you want to comment on this one?
Yeah, I mean, very shortly, in the case of humanitarian action, there is a shift within the field right now and it's also linked to the political project. I mean, the nature of humanitarian institutions has changed over time, so the kind of spatial strategy that they rely on is no longer adapted to the temporalities of the current crises of the political goals that they've set themselves, or the political position or role that they play in crises. I thought that was a very interesting framework to use space as a way to understand these new kind of, at least for me, these new political roles.
Well, I think that Luis and Marianne sort of said it. I think the only thing to add is just that if there is something about urban design, traditional urban design, in terms of responding to specific aspirations, or sort of trying to achieve certain goals in terms of linear productivity, when we start thinking at sort of the ephemeral and its impact in the continuous construction of the city, what we discover is that there is there are different itineraries of urban development and occupation, and then all those itineraries become visible
And when we see that cities are actually occupied and being produced at different speeds and cyclically, as well as sometimes linearly, because production and I don't know, and I suppose there is some certain lineality in the, in the problems that you're addressing. So then one needs to understand that there is a much more complex object of study, which is not the simplified city of the Siam, I suppose.
In fact, just to extend it in a speculative way, imagine if you had cities and when permission was given to building, for example, you were granted, like you have leases for 90 years or 99 years or 999 years, maybe there were zones not by land use, but there were zones by how much time you got to build there, almost in terms of these cycles, which means intelligent developers would build very lightly if they got permission only for 10 years, looking at the life cycle of those materials, because the city might feel it might need to change and twitch, which is the diagram of your collapsing the camp in the city. In a sense, that made me sort of think about an imagination like this. So it has implications vis-a-vis the design and protocols, and you know, it's very interesting.
Okay. I'm sorry I came in so late, but when you mentioned capitalism, and I had been talking to somebody about China's role in Africa, and I was wondering whether China, I had heard that they were going to build roads in India, and for some reason I had thought it was very exploitive, but now I'm all of a sudden reconsidering it and wondering if China in the East has something to add to, like you said, that capitalism doesn't seem to have taken, but if China in the East have something to actually add to what you're doing.
To my work?
To like the infrastructure, right, building.
Yeah, no, I think it's a very interesting question. When I went to China for the first time, I was struck by this very aggressive mercantile economy, the way in which they relate to you, invite you to participate in activities and so on, the way in which they sell things to you, and the tremendous vibrancy of the market in China, and of course their participation in projects in Africa. They're now trying to build a new Panama Canal, but in Nicaragua, and railways in Colombia and Chile, and you know, all sorts of projects everywhere. So I sort of almost came to the conclusion that the most capitalist country in the world is China. Is this continuous revaluation of the dominant system that I suppose in several years ago Deleuze in his famous book A Thousand Plateaus, trying to explain what a rhizome is, he said, you know, he gave multiple examples of what rhizomes are, but he says capitalism is the prime example of what a rhizome is, because capitalism is always new. There is never always old capitalism. It is always new. It is always renewing itself and adapting itself to new circumstances. And I think that China is this new incarnation of a capitalism contemporary, if you like.
I had heard that they were planning to do, you know, to invest in India too, in the infrastructure, and that was specifically why I asked the question.
Yeah, I don't know what they're doing in India.
Well, they've just begun to discuss this. Nothing has happened yet, so I don't know. It's tough to reflect upon it right now. One more question.
I'm wondering if the word ephemeral is the adequate word that you should use in this wonderful project that you have and a reality which I follow and appreciate. How can you call ephemeral when Potosi, discovered in the 16th century, became a city and continues to be a city? Or when another mine in Mexico, discovered in 1540s, continues to produce silver, when even in the case that you worked on, the river erases the traces, but the traces are there, and they bring everything, and the plants are there, and every year, for how long has this festival been?
They say 5,000 years, but I'm not sure.
You know, how can you call that ephemeral? This is what is ephemeral? Is it in comparison with the buildings in New York and in Chicago, in the high rise? I mean the skyscrapers. I mean, that's what.
Yeah. No, so actually you lead me to my last question to the panelists, so this might actually answer it a bit, which, again, I think time becomes an important... Sorry, you had a question? Okay, so why don't you add, and then I'll ask a question. Sure, of course. Very pleasure to have you. No, please, pleasure.
It's a very interesting point that she's raising, and that's exactly the point that I was asking myself when I saw these presentations. I think they were fantastic presentations, very interesting. The problem I had was exactly what she's saying. I mean, is it temporary or ephemeral? Because ephemeral has a completely different meaning than temporary. And temporary can be repeated many times because it's part of sometimes traditions, memories, cultures, idiosyncrasies, situations, conditions, etc. So all the cases and the approaches were very, very interesting. My problem is how to bring them all together into a word that I don't think it is the word to be used in this case.
No, so that exactly is the struggle, and that's part of the research which is in progress. And I want to end with a question to you, but also just respond to it. It's interesting, I mean, and it's a very relevant question because, well, one thing is a lot of these things, including the Kumbh Mela or every market that he showed, they do reappear, but they're never the same. They are enacted processes that have their variations. They're never the same. So it's not, it is temporary in its nature, in its construct, but it's ephemeral because it disappears. It leaves different kinds of traces, but doesn't reappear in the same way. So, I mean, for the Kumbh, I didn't have time to go into it, but it actually reflects town planning trends at that time. So when Corbusier did the Chandigarh, we suddenly had sectors that 12 years, the first one after that 12 years. Before that, it was chaotic. There wasn't a grid. So the phenomena repeats itself, but the moment of occupation, in a sense, is ephemeral, temporary. We are struggling between these two words. Yeah, no, I'm not sure. So this is the struggle we are having too, and that's why it's part of the process. And I think defining the taxonomy is one way of nuancing it, because that will also vary. The taxonomies which have refuge and disaster and spreading out these, I mean, because it's also not the same. It might not all neatly fit into one category, for example, like the market that he showed. What is... with the train track, where the infrastructure. What is the word? It's not temporary. Not in either one form. It's not in either one form. Which part is permanent and nothing? I think the essence of what at least we are trying to do is trying to just question some of the presumptions with which urbanism is discussed. And if you challenge it with these conditions, maybe the result will be something else. So that's why it becomes a work in progress, but they're all very relevant questions. Just leads me to getting very brief comments from you for the last thing, which is linked to this, which is what you raised with that theme park, of the question of memory. Because when these are enacted moments, there's nothing that captures the memory. In fact, that is ephemeral in a sense. And so this idea of memory, of the transient, how does it play out in the situations that each of you are researching? Because, of course, in camps, it begins to have certain connotations, and even in terms of expression, you kind of alluded to it a little bit in your talk. And, of course, Felipe, you might end and close the discussion. So, Luis, what?
Well, first, answering Maritz, I knew you would come with a tough question. I put the word ephemeral just to get into this panel, you know? No, I'm joking. I think there's, I don't like it to put it as a duality between ephemeral and permanent. I think that's quite of a narrow road to go through and just compare is it or not, and you get
which
the
is
answer.
What temporary does, sorry. Temporary sets, I mean, one problem with temporary was it sets you up in this binary.
Yeah,
in so that we were binary. Trying to avoid that word.
So I think for in our discussion, in our research, it opens a much more complexity that what urban designers or urban planners are doing conventionally. So it's an opening of a new framework, a more flexible, a more stackable in a certain way situation in which you can put different realities into a certain place and space, which we're talking about. But it has, at the end, it has a strong degree of ephemerality. For example, the floating population in Calama is the biggest floating population in any city in Chile. Today, as one third of the population flies in and flies out of Calama towards other cities in Chile, even to other cities in Latin America. The new expansion of one of the mines, which is the state mine of Codelco, will increase the floating population to the half of the city. So you will have a half of the city flying in and flying out permanently. So again, what is the address of that person? What is the residence of that person? What is the relationship to the family and work, which you used to have also in the conventional understanding of urban planning as a different zones inside one single city, as a unit of space and time. Now that is decomposed and is relativized. So it is about relativity in terms of space and time in a certain way, not in the Einstein terms of relativity, but in this new understanding of how we develop in these landscapes of extraction. So it has things of ephemerality by certainty, as this example of, I'm just putting an example of that. If you bring towards the discussion of governance, which also was mentioned a little bit, is also a great struggle of how do you establish permanent rules to every changing situation and context and production and economy. How can you will always, and we discussed this with Felipe in the panel last Saturday, government and rules of governing will always be late, will always come behind, because this has a certain dynamic of change that is always one or two steps in front of you. So you need to think much more about a more temporal governance frameworks or understanding of things, for example. So those are the new kind of spaces and frames that ephemerality in terms of extraction is opening up. I think this is a door of entrance to a new scope, a new vision. I don't think that this may be the door of going out of this whole research in terms of Rahul's and everybody that is looking into this might be a very different one. But it's a very interesting door to go in. So I take it very much on that kind of adventure and also risk. And in terms of your question of the memory is a tough question. It is, again, one of the questions that the most segregated group of people in this place actually are the ones that pretty much understand it best, which are the indigenous communities. And there comes, again, the thing of what memory allows to legitimacy in the belonging of a place and of a space, and that what you have memory of that space, of your people that were there before, and how you have occupied the space, but also the cosmovision of that space in terms of how you transfer knowledge as part of your memory, is also something that these indigenous people that are actually quite segregated out of the city in a oasis that is actually shrinking and dying. These are the people that actually can bring up issues as the memory, as the belonging, as the true understanding, even if you are flying in and flying out in these places.
Yeah, I'll try to be very brief. So in the context of humanitarian urbanism, the memory plays, I think, in two levels. So there's the memory of the institution, which is something that I'm trying to kind of unpack, the institutional memory and these kind of this reliance and replication of old models that are not adapted anymore. And then there's the memory of the refugee. And it reminds me of the paper that I wrote in your class, where taking Kabul as a case study and the memory, like, so how do you rebuild Kabul once with a population that has no memory of the city, and the humanitarian institutions that are there to rebuild have no memory of the city. So yeah, there are different levels, really interesting.
the responsibility. Yes, I think the question about ephemeral is essential, I suppose. You know, it sort of embodies the very essence of the conversation that we're trying to have. I sort of went through a series of words trying to really explain. So I used transient or temporal and ephemeral. I suppose the question of ephemeral definitely makes more sense to me against the monumental architecture, sort of the building that stays, the perennial presence in the physical fabric of the city. So when we talk about the ephemeral, very much we refer to these architectures which are materially different to that monumental architecture, and they're constantly changing, and for that reason are reconstituting themselves gradually. Which connects very nicely all the questions that have been asked, because it's this idea also of the cyclical in the development of the city, as opposed to the linear understanding of urban development, gradual development of the city, and so on and so forth. And that closes with the notion of memory. I think that in addition to the physical construction and continuous development of the concrete material city, there is also the narrative construction. Yeah? And there are all these different identities which participate in the developments of cities, all of them maintaining a particular narrative. Not that those narratives are disconnected from one another, but they do develop in independent ways. Mm-hmm. I suppose the experiences of the indigenous people, of ethnic minorities, religious minorities, and so on, and how is it that there are these moments of interaction? And I think it is in that narrative construction that we see the appearance of memory as I don't know how to call it, element perhaps or dimension, which is inherent to cities, and where we see what I was trying to explain, you know, that even those things are cyclical and perhaps temporal or ephemeral in terms of their materiality and so on, they do have a more permanent dimension. So I think there's like what Luis was saying is this is perhaps not the problem is when we try to see it in dichotomic terms, mm-hmm. as if there were opposites, as if the ephemeral was against the permanent. But I think that there is something
Lovely note to end on. So thank you for that. Thanks to all of you. Really wonderful insights that you've shared. And thanks for you all coming and participating. It's really very, very important for us. And lastly, to the Rockefeller Center and to the South Asia Institute for supporting the broader research and the exhibition. And, you know, we had to postpone this, but it finally happened. And that's what's important. So thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you.